long leather is comfy, durable, and fashionable as heck, but it is not exactly sustainable. Researchers have been developing leather alternatives, and the latest one, covered in the journal Nature Biotechnology, even dyes itself black. So let's talk about a material that may contain science. Inventors have produced leather alternatives since the 19th century. The first one was invented in Germany and called Prestoff. It's made of resin-treated and layered paper pulp, and it really does look just like leather. Germans used it in a bunch of applications when animal leather became scarce during World War II, except for things that required flexibility or moisture wicking, at which point Prestoff promptly remembers that it's made of paper and falls apart. In fact, the search for leather alternatives is littered with downsides like that. The most famous and still most common so-called vegan leathers are plastics made from materials like polyurethane and polyvinyl chloride. Downsides may include being super squeaky, not being terribly breathable as a fabric, and of course, being made from plastic and therefore not a terribly biodegradable material. So unlike Prestoff, these plastic leather alternatives don't fall apart for 500 years or more. We may have swung too far in the other direction there. So with those drawbacks, it's not surprising that materials engineers have not treated these plastic-coated fabrics as the final answer in leather alternatives. In more recent years, we've seen advances in leather-like textiles made from plants and even mushrooms. Materials made from pineapple leaves and apple or grape waste can be turned into leather. Cork can be sustainably harvested from cork oak trees and turned into something that, I mean, if you ignored the texture, kind of resembles leather. And mushroom leather can be grown on a substrate of agricultural waste, then smooshed into a textile. But unfortunately for all of these, they have the same problem as Prestoff. They're just not as durable as animal leather. In fact, most plant-based leather alternatives typically have polyurethane added to them to compensate for that durability issue. Which brings us right back to plastics. Albeit less plastic overall, so still definitely a win. And other plants, like cactus-based leather, are showing promise, so plant leathers, there's hope for you yet. At their core, plant-based leather alternatives, in fact, pretty much all plant-based textiles, are mostly cellulose, the main polymer found in plant cell walls. But plants aren't the only organism that synthesizes cellulose. Some bacteria can do it too. For instance, Comagata A. bacter xylanus, the bacteria used to make kombucha, synthesize their own cellulose. On a molecular level, cellulose is cellulose, whether from plants or bacteria. But materials are more than just what molecule they're made from, and bacterial and plant cellulose, nano and microfibrils, are organized differently. Here, plant cellulose is on the left, while bacterial cellulose is on the right. And these two images are at the same scale. And at the risk of stating the obvious, bacteria, they aren't plants. So bacterial cellulose doesn't contain impurities like hemicellulose, pectin, or lignin, which are other polysaccharides that give plants their structure along with cellulose, and which also alter the properties of the material. Cotton, for instance, is very high purity, high cellulose content, and that, along with its fiber structure, give it many of the textile properties we know it for. So the question is, do these differences between plant and bacterial cellulose make for a better leather-like material? In some ways, yes. Due to its structure, bacterial cellulose tends to have higher tensile strength than plant-based leather alternatives, and one study showed that leather derived from bacterial cellulose has even higher abrasion resistance than animal leather. All of which makes bacterial cellulose leather really promising. But everything I've told you up to this point has been published before. In fact, last year, at the Global Fashion Summit, a materials startup and design firm teamed up to showcase a blazer made from this stuff. And frankly, on its own, bacterial cellulose leather could easily end up on an ever-growing pile of promising leather alternatives, but not much more notable than apple leather or mycelium leather. Now, this recent article from Nature Biotechnology showcases one of the features that makes bacterial cellulose so much freaking cooler. See, the thing is, we're really good at hacking bacteria. What if we made the bacteria dye the leather themselves? See, commercial dyes aren't the easiest to produce sustainably, and apparently some colors more than others. Black, notably, is difficult to produce sustainably. But you may notice from the hair atop my head that I, for instance, am a rock star at dyeing my hair black, and no, not through tinted conditioners or drugstore box dye. In fact, I, a human mammal, dye my own hair at the follicle level thanks to the wonders of melanin. When we talked about color-changing fish, I mentioned melanin as the source of black coloration. Cells produce melanin, which acts as a pigment. But just like plants aren't the only ones producing cellulose, animals aren't the only ones making melanin, bacteria can too. Now, the bacteria that make cellulose and the bacteria that make melanin are different species of bacteria, but we're really, really good at splicing genes into bacteria. For instance, we used to get insulin by purifying it from animals, but in the late 1970s, researchers figured out how to get E. coli to express genes to produce human insulin. And now, biosynthesis is the runaway most common method for the production of recombinant human insulin around the world. So, do our cellulose-producing bacteria naturally produce eumelanin? Nope. But previous bioengineers had gotten E. coli and Vibrio bacteria to produce recombinant eumelanin before, and it turns out you only need to throw in a single enzyme to catalyze the rate-limiting step in bacterial eumelanin synthesis. So a quick splicey-splicey, and now our cellulose-producing bacteria, K. reticus, can now produce cellulose and melanin. Just not at the same time. Apparently, melanin synthesis is pH sensitive, and our bacteria needed to run at one pH level for the cellulose production and another to make melanin, so it was a bit of a two-parter. First, our researchers got the bacteria to grow the material. You can either grow a piece in a big old rectangle dish and cut to the desired shape, or you can grow your leather inside of a dish shaped to the desired object. Initial choices for this study included a leather wallet and the leather upper part of a shoe. Once the bacteria had produced the material, the engineers swapped the culture medium from growing the material to a higher pH dyeing the material culture medium and placed the culture dish on a shaker so the bacteria didn't keep producing extra cellulose during the dyeing stage. Then, voila! I agree. Look on the shoes a bit out of style, but bacteria grew this. We can't ding them on their fashion sense. Like good engineers, our researchers tested to ensure that the tensile strength and properties of the cellulose leather were unchanged by the introduction of the enzyme to make melanin or other confounding factors. And after they finished being responsible, they clearly thought to themselves, how can we make this funky? And they answered that in the most biology nerd way possible, creating patterns in the textile using spatial gene expression. See, cells don't max out synthesis of every protein at every minute. Cells express a subset of their genes at any given time, many in response to specific physical and chemical cues, like mechanical force or sensing certain chemicals in the air. So, when you have a bunch of bacteria making cellulose, then synthesizing melanin to dye that cellulose, how do you make some of them express that melanin gene, but not other bacteria in that same dish, and do so with a very precise pattern? The answer was to create a second strain of K. reticus, only instead of just constitutively synthesizing melanin, they put it under a light-sensitive RNA polymerase designed to only regulate the one target gene we want it to target. since we know that some biological phenomena are light-sensitive, gene expression regulated by light makes some sense. And in the end, what we have is a light-sensitive gene that then regulates our target gene, which in this case is that key enzyme for bacterial melanin synthesis. So the idea is you shine a blue light on the bacteria, they produce melanin and the leather is black. Don't shine it, and the leather is white. So they put a little light projector over the culture dish and projected a pattern in blue light onto the dish. Where there was blue light, the bacteria made melanin, and where there wasn't, the bacteria didn't. The results look pretty good. Ever the perfectionists, our engineers were like, well, we could get better contrast in the pattern with a larger dynamic range of the optogenetic system, but seriously, they got bacteria to engineer a pattern into a textile. Take the win, science! But what's cool about the pattern isn't just the pattern. Even though, again, this is the most over-engineered, brilliant solution to fashion design I've ever seen. It's cool because it's an example of what we can do with bioengineering. With most material science, we're limited to some extent by the inputs we work with. Pineapple leaves are pretty much pineapple leaves, and we can do different stuff to them. But the base material doesn't change that much. With bacterial cellulose, though, we can use biology itself to modify the material as it's made. This isn't just the finished product. This can be a platform for further experimentation using all the tools and all the toys of bioengineering at our disposal. And likewise, better understanding of the underlying biology gives engineers better toys to play with. One thing they noted in this paper was that the self-dyeing bacterial cellulose used more water due to the extra step of adjusting the pH, but that by better understanding pH-sensitive elements of the melanin biosynthesis pathway, they may be able to reduce or eliminate that extra water usage. Basic science and applied engineering working together. And at this point, you may be thinking, this is getting weird. Do we really want to hack bacteria to do this stuff? Is this getting into mad science territory? But remember I mentioned that bacteria synthesize recombinant insulin? We synthesize tons of pharmaceuticals and molecules using engineered bacteria now. Those techniques aren't really in the public eye much, but they are a staple of modern biology. Bacteria that can make a textile, dye it, and do so in a specific pattern sounds like a wild leap. Really, this project combines several cutting-edge but established techniques. It just does them in a cool way and toward a cool purpose. So I'm excited about bacterial cellulose as a leather alternative. Just like every material, it has its downsides. It has higher tensile strength than plant leather, but its breathability isn't awesome, and it can still get easily waterlogged. Whether our researchers can engineer their way out of that is a question they ask for future studies. Can bacteria synthesize a hydrophobic layer to add waterproofing? So, even if bacterial cellulose is, for the moment, in broadly the same category of usefulness as plant-based leather alternatives, this study shows how it has the potential to become so, so much more. And whatever that is, it may be coming soon to a fashion show near you.